and mobile technologies exclusively for last 4 years. I have been, I have delivered quite a few large enterprise applications using JavaScript technologies. And as part of it, you know, somewhere in last 1.5 years, I came across Webpack, and I really realized that it's a fairly complicated beast to tame. So I went a bit deep, and that is the experience that I'm going to share with you guys here. So, if you are impatient and you don't want to go with me, you can always refer the slides here. And the app that I'm going to show you as part of the presentation is can be found here. I will again share the link at the last slide as well, so don't have to worry about the app. Slides, if you want to hurry up, you can take the slides right away on your mobile and charge it. My Twitter username, if you want to follow me, I regularly post on Twitter. So let's start. So I hope all of you know what Webpack is. Who knows Webpack is? What Webpack is? Or use Webpack? Okay, quite a few. Awesome. And those who did not raise your hands, but use CRA, Create React Tag. Awesome. So all these guys, you did not raise the hand earlier, but you use Create React Tag, right? That means you are using Webpack, you just don't know it. Okay? So So that's the beauty of Create React App, that it abstracts away all the complexities of Webpack. But at the same time, you know, when it abstracts away all the complexities, then whenever you want to do something specific, you are going to have a little bit hard time. So thankfully, Create React App has a eject functionality by which you can eject the entire configuration, including Webpack configuration, and then you can go deep dive as how I am going to show you in this particular session. So for those who do not know what Webpack is, this is a quick primer for you. Developers all around the world, the Angular developers, React developers, Vue developers, all of them really love Webpack, and all of their CLIs are using Webpack as their base build system. Why? Because there are a lot of features that are present in Webpack, and so one of the key features that is there and which is loved by developers is a versatile loading system. Now, what is versatile loading system means, even? Right? So basically, it can read and understand a lot of different types of files. So if you look at predecessor to Webpack, Gulp, Babel, etc., Gulp and Grunt, etc., right? They were spaghetti of plugins. Here also there are a lot of plugins, but the core Webpack itself also can understand the JavaScript file, CSS file, image files like PNG, JPEG, GIF, SVG. You name it, font files, PDF files, all these type of files are something that Webpack can load from file system and can understand them, and so it can process them. What do you mean by process? So the processing would be essentially bundling some of these files together and also splitting some of these files out. So what if I'm talking two different things which are opposite of each other at the same time really. So let's say I have written an application having 100 JavaScript files. I can bundle them all into one, or I can bundle them into one and then split that one into five, right? So bundling and splitting, this is the most biggest power of Webpack probably, that it allows you to bundle not just JavaScript files, it allows you to bundle CSS files, it allows you to transform SCSS, LESS, stylus, different styling files, again bundle them together, or you can then split them again if you want to. You can take JPEG, GIF images or SVG images, create sprites out of it. So all this bundling and splitting game is the true power of Webpack, and that's why Webpack is so powerful and is loved all over the world. Thirdly, it also gives you built-in cache bursting system. So those who have dealt with releases, you will know that moment you release the application, new files are not reflecting to the end users, and then everybody is having panicky calls and all that. So don't have to worry about it anymore. Once you have Webpack, your files will always have uniquely different names every time new release happens. So your old file names, that old release used, are gone. So your cache is definitely busted. So you don't have to worry about it. So we are going to, talk about this bundling and bundle tuning in the forthcoming part of the talk. And the second part, which is again very, very powerful, is the tree shaking and minification. So if I have hundreds of files written, obviously, with lots of ports commented, because this does not work right now. This used to work earlier, I don't want it now, but I don't want to delete it, etc., etc., right? Or I have a jQuery.js because I forgot to write jQuery.min.js, etc., right? So it will automatically minify for you. You don't have to find out the minified version of any file. Yeah. So it will do minification for you, and it will also do tree shaking for you. Now, somebody, I forgot who, showed what tree shaking means. I think Manjula in the morning in the hall. So basically, if you have five functions in your JavaScript and if you are only referring two of them in your other parts of the application, then it intelligently understands that only those two functions are really required for you in the runtime. So it will drop the rest tree. It is literally taking a tree and shaking it, you know, so that the dry leaves will fall down. You don't need them, let them go. Same thing. Lastly, it is highly customizable and pluggable. It is very easy to write a plugin to a product to enhance the functionality that is not available but you want it, right? So that will be one of the key reason why the ecosystem is very thriving here. About 250 plugins exist for Webpack, and lot of new things are getting written added to Webpack ecosystem. That's why Webpack is so popular and being used now. But if we use all that goodness, does that mean we can rest in peace? No. Okay, of course not. Because just because it has a lot of configurability, it does not make it a smart system. So, it has some algorithm, obviously, and it tries to apply that algorithm. And, there are thousands of projects, hundreds of thousands of projects getting written. So, not every project turns out to be right. Then, all these projects are using different libraries. Those all are written maybe sometimes in past, sometimes new. So every library has its own quirks. So this system is not a smart system. So sometimes it needs a little bit of nudging here and there. You need to tell Webpack, boss, you tried, but you have to do it this way, you have to do it that way, so that it will do it correctly for you. Why is it important? Because if you don't do this, then you are going to get big bloated bundles created by Webpack. Right? I said Webpack is true power is about bundling, but that bundles can sometimes be created in an incorrect fashion and you get then big bundles. So you are loading your home page. I think Manjula again mentioned that her time to interactive was 8 seconds or something, and 440 KB was her bundle size. So that's a very good decent bundle size, I would say 440 KB. But what if you have 2.5 MB of bundle size? 1 MB takes about 10 seconds on a slow 3G network. So if you have 2.5 minutes, 25 seconds, the user is not able to do anything. That's ridiculous. Nobody's going to stay on your application, right? So bloated bundles is absolute no-no for everybody, right? And you, all of you, whoever are developing with Webpack, now that Webpack is there in Great React App, right? Check what is your bundle size, yeah? And if it is really big, then you really, really need this session's content for it. Okay, so that's what we are going to do. We are going to try and fix this big bloated bundle. Obviously, there is no one formula that fits all here. I'm going to show you some specific examples and hopefully that will inspire you to look at other cases, whatever you are going to deal in your situation. So I start with my product's experience first to just give you how this is important, the bundling bundle QB. So this is how my Angular application, I'm not a React guy, sorry. So this was my Angular application before I started tuning. Yeah. So it was about two and a half months in my development with my team, and I had total application size of 5.73 MB, non-GSIP. Okay. And it's okay because my main applications were only these two. These are the ones which are getting downloaded on the homepage. So it was not terribly bad, but still 5 MB was too much for me. So I started looking into what is happening really. I went and did a lot of research and finally tuned it, and this is the after I have done my tuning. This was the result that I got, about 2.6 MB without GZIP. So it's about 700 KB GZIP, which is okay, which is not terribly bad. And again, I still had the AOT compiler, something Angular forcefully injects in my, sometimes it injects, so I need to remove it, so it will save me about 5 MB. So I'm just close to getting there. So but that was the thing, that I could save almost 50% of my JavaScript that was, so what I realized was 50% of JavaScript that was getting shipped to the browser was useless. It was not even getting used, right? And that is something eye-opener for me. So I'm going to show you how you can also, look at your application's bundle and do similar exercises. Okay? So how do you go about it? In order to do this, the most important tool is already built in into your Webpack system. So if you are using Webpack, you have that tool. And that tool is called JSON. Okay? Webpack-JSON. Now, those who are using Create React App, at this juncture, Create React App does not have a way to pass this particular parameter to Webpack. directly. So only way out for you is to do a separate clone, eject it, and then run with the JSON tag. In Angular CLI world and Vue world, thankfully, you can pass the JSON tag already. And you can create the bundle report. Basically, it creates a bundle report for you in a JSON format. And that formatted report is really not really readable or comprehensible for the user, I mean end user. So then there are a couple of tools that people have written, which can, you know, parse that JSON and create a meaningful visualization for you. So why three tools? Because they offer different type of output for you. And we are going to see all the three briefly. So instead of reading through here, I am going to show you. So here is the Webpack's own tool, Webpack analyzer, webpack.github.io analyze. So as you can see, I have loaded a JSON file here. The JSON file is something that gets created by the Webpack. And it tells me that there are 3 chunks and 14 assets, 164 modules in it, etc. And I can see here all the chunks. Yeah, there are 3 chunks. Okay, it gives me details for each chunk size. And it also tells me all these 165 modules that we spoke about. Here are all the 165 modules that are there. And the most important page probably I like out of this particular analyzer is the hint, which seems to be good in this particular demo app that I have. But in my actual production app, I had like pages full of hints here because there were a lot of duplication. So basically, I was using, let's say, movement.js in this chunk and that chunk and that chunk. So I was pushing the same JavaScript into 3 chunks for the end user. So he said, okay, why are you doing that? Can you take it out and move it into a common chunk so that it does not get repeated? Right? Those are the type of hints that this particular analyzer gives. Very useful page for you to use. Now, but what I don't like about it is it doesn't give me a very good bird's eye view about the sizes. So that is where I really like this visualizer from Chris Bateman. Yeah. So it gives you a what is known as sunburst chart. Yeah. So you can select the chunks. You can see all the chunks, and you can see individual chunks. So for example, this is my vendor chunk here, and it tells me now that 100% of vendor chunk is from node modules only. So everything in vendor chunk is from node modules. Out of that, 23% is my Lodash library. And you know, by eyeballing, I can see what things are, you know, are there. Open layers is about 20%, etc. So it is a very beautiful representation of, you know, where am I spending large chunks in, large parts of my chunk are going, right? And this is another library called Thor's Bundle Analyzer. I like this one also because it clearly tells me which library, where is it, which is the largest straight away. There is OLJS, there is D3JS, and you know my application code is here, the blue code. Yeah, this is my application code. Okay, so those are the, by the way, while we are here, this will be the demo app that I am going to use because the next slide will show that anyway. Let me just confirm it. Oh yeah, that's it. So I built a very simple app for demonstration purpose. Obviously, it's a, you know, it's not a real world app, but I just you know, took five pages or 5 components, yeah, and one header. So the first page or the home page only uses Bootstrap to create one tab button, that's all, and to lay things out, and also the top nav and all that. Then there is this movement.js page where, you know, I'm using movement.js to just do something because it's a demo app. Obviously, I use open layers to create the map. And yeah, I have throttled the connection right now. So then I use another page to use Lodash pick function. Yeah. Just to demonstrate that I'm using Lodash and one D3 page. Yeah, that's my application. Essentially, my application uses Vue.js, it uses D3, it uses Movement.js, and Open Layer and Lodash. Okay, those are the things my application depends upon. Yeah. And then as we were seeing, This is how the Thor's bundle analyzer look like. Yeah. So obviously, you know, I started thinking, boss, why is there, I have such a big open layers JS sitting in my code, right? Then again, this D3JS looks terribly big. This movement.js, okay, there is movement.js library, but what is this big item from movement.js? That is the locales folder. Yeah. If you zoom in and see there, it has Russian and Armenian and Italian and all that. But I'm not supporting those languages, but it's still there in my application. I did not ask for it, but it's still there, right? So that's where Webpack has gone wrong. Yeah. Then there is also Lodash, which is fairly big for me, right? So those were my leads that I could get from, you know, analyzer. So that's what you guys need to do. You need to somehow create a strategy and load it up and try out, right? And last and most important thing that I realized here is that I have only one vendor JS file, meaning everything that I need for this application to work is there in one JS file. But really, do I need open layers D3 in my homepage? I don't need it. But it is still there. It is going to get downloaded, right? So first and foremost thing that I need to really do is go for lazy loading. Strip out everything and anything that I don't need on my homepage. So my homepage performance will go better. Okay, so from this point onwards, now we will actually go a little bit deeper into the code now, and I'm going to show you how small changes in your code or configuration files can lead to, you know, removing these issues. So first, let us attack the biggest problem: lazy loading. So this is how my So this is how my Vue.js file look. Yeah, I know that you guys don't. I don't expect you guys to know Vue.js, but it is very similar to how React would have done. So I have components, my components, movement page, Lodash page, all those components, and I have a router which loads all these things, right? But what is important to note here is that I have statically imported them here in JavaScript. Statically. That means when the code parsing happens via Webpack, it is going to load all of them and hardwire them into the application. Now what I'm going to do is, I'm going to change over to dynamic import rather than a static import. Now dynamic import is not a JavaScript thing, it's something that is Webpack has given to you. So normal non-Webpack applications can't work. So anything that is in red is removed, by the way. Anything in green is added, yeah. So I removed all these static imports and I go for this import with the curly brace. That is the dynamic import facility. This is exactly same facility that is available in React router as well. So if you are using React and if you are not doing lazy loading, this is how you need to do in your React applications. Yeah? Use dynamic imports. Immediately whatever is here will be created as a separate chunk for you. So let's say the movement page or component referred movement JS, that means now movement is not going to come in your home page wala JS. Yeah? So that is the kind of benefit you are going to get, and in this dummy app, this is the benefit that you are going to see. So before the earlier application, home page JS was 358 KB and after it is 39 KB, so like 90% improvement. That's a huge, so that's why you have to attack if you are not using lazy loading. That should be the first thing that you should always attack. Moving on to open layers now. So this is my open layers is mapping library, like, you know, Google Maps, right? So this is how I was using it. Open layers, import OL from open layers, and then OL had variety of functions. OL.map, OL.tile, OL.projection, OL.view, bagaira bagaira. Right. So this is the typical code of creating a simple map for you, but obviously since it is import OL from open layers, it is bringing the whole open layers library, right? Which is not a ES2015 library. Open layers, the original version, is a common JS based library. Now this statement probably is going to stump some of you guys, so just ignore what I am saying. Just whenever you are googling, you find out libraries which are ES2015 compliant, okay? And open layers fortunately has a library called OL, same code base but exported as ES2015. Okay, so we have to start using the OL library now. That is the key thing that we have to change. Once we start using the OL library, yeah, I removed the import OL from open layers, and instead I started referring from OL/layer tile, OL/map, etc. Now why this is better? Because here I'm specifically saying I want this module out of your OL library, that module out of your OL library, and that's why it is only going to take those many things, pre-shake everything else. And that's why if you want to use pre-shaking, you have to have ES2015 based libraries. And this is one example where I could fortunately find a ES2015 enabled library, so I used it, and the result is that otherwise it was a 146 KB library for me. Now it is 86 KB only. Yeah, that is the benefit that I got. Same thing you will be able to see in case of D3. I'm sure, you know, maybe 50% of you would have been exposed to D3, right? And typically this is how you would have used it. the older version, that is V3, V3, if you have used, D3, V3 was always imported like this, start as D3. Now D3, V3 again was a common JS based library, and D3, V4 is a ES 2015 based library. And now in V4 they have also splitted everything out into individual modules, separated out, and that's why I am saying, boss, I don't want your D3, rather just give me D3 selection, because that is all I really need right now for my requirement. And I change my code like this. I remove the original star as D3 and I just import one function. Yeah, there was a lot of talk about pure function, right? So this is just a pure function. So everything else just goes away. You don't need anything else, right? And you know, I then just use that new function that I imported. Everything, the rest of the code remains same. That is also a highlight that I wanted to underscore in all these changes, that the changes are minimal. It's not like you are rewriting your app, but you are getting benefits. So that's why it's a very important activity that you should be doing, in my opinion. And this is the improvement in this dummy app. Don't go by the numbers, because of course you are not just using D3 select. You are using many more functions, so you will not get such kind of benefit. But in this app, I was able to get almost 80%, 85% benefit from 71 KB to just 9 KB. Now, these two cases that I showed earlier to you is where using the ES 2015 and tree shaking could help me to optimize my bundles. But there are other cases where you don't have ES 2015 library. Just say Lodash. Now that statement is half true, I come to that. But Lodash is common JS library, it is not a ES 2015 library. And whole bunch of you use Lodash, I'm sure. Right? So if you have something like this import underscore from Lodash, then obviously the entire library is coming. But since it's a common JS library, even if you do something like this, import pick from Lodash pick, it will still import the entire library, because that's how Webpack works. Webpack is not able to do tree shaking if the library is not ES2015. Okay? So this statement can mislead you. Yeah, maine ye kiya hai. Sorry, I'm switching things. Even if I have done this, why am I still getting the whole Lodash library? Because Lodash is not a ES2015 library. Okay? And now I said half true, because Lodash-ES, there is a library called Lodash-ES, which is the ES2015 library, you can use it. Okay? But that will only serve you if you are the only one who is using Lodash. Let's say you had a library import, third party library, which was using Lodash. Your Lodash-ES is not going to be any useful, because that Lodash is still getting used, no option. Right? So that's why you have to nudge Webpack in a different way now. Okay, and that's where the plugin ecosystem really comes handy. And if you look at the plugin ecosystem, I'm loading this Lodash module replacement plugin, or rather the name, right name is Lodash Webpack plugin, which is a plugin written by Lodash guys themselves, right? And all you need to do is, in your Webpack configuration file, you need to give the reference to that module. Now this Webpack configuration file, those who use Create React App, you will not find it. Those who use Angular CLI, you won't find it. You must eject. And then only you will find this particular part. Yeah. So, but yeah, sometimes you know benefits outweigh the ease that is being given. Because see here, from 23 KB I am down to 3 KB. Right? So definitely there is a benefit of doing eject and then doing your own configuration. Second such example is movement JS. Right? Now, if you remember, I had shown you a screenshot. I have just blown it up for you. So you can see Russian and I don't know EL. And then I don't even know Italian, yeah, lot of languages which I am not supporting really, right? Then why do I need to have movements translation, movement JS codes translation in all those languages, right? Even my own codes translation in those languages is not there with me. So, but again, that's how movement and Webpack are not really ready to talk to each other. There is a long thread on movement JS GitHub issue where people are saying, why don't you fix it? Then they say, no, that's how it works. Webpack should fix it.
Yeah.
So it happens that two open source libraries don't talk to each other nicely. Yeah. So thankfully there is a built-in plugin from Webpack itself which can help us, which says context replacement plugin, and it says whenever I come across a path that which says movement/locales, I only want to include these languages. So then it will drop everything else and only take English, Hindi, and Marathi. Only, and then obviously you have to add as on how you grow. Yeah? So that is one more example where, you know, ES 2015 thing did not came into your way or did not help you or any, so you have to depend on a plugin. And I'm sure that you will find in your application some such problematic libraries, and then you will have to find out the right plugin for helping you. Or you can roll up your own plugin. That's also not a very difficult thing to do in Webpack. So again, the benefit was I came down from 92 KB to 18 KB. Now 18 KB is pretty much the movement JS library itself, because hardly any, maybe 1 KB is just the translations, you know. Now those are some examples of JavaScript being optimized. Here is another example of CSS being optimized. So I was using Bootstrap, as I showed on the first page. I was just using Bootstrap button, right? So I started up with Bootstrap min.css in my style. Yeah, directly imported Bootstrap min.css. Now Bootstrap min.css is bringing a lot of things, actually these many things. Okay, I don't expect you to read. I just want to explain you that for me the blue things were sufficient. But since I had brought the Bootstrap min.css, there was no way to pick and choose. And that's why we should be rather going to a SCSS mode. SCSS or stylized CSS? I don't know. I forgot. Stylized. Okay, so if we use that, then we can write a custom file to pick and choose individual Bootstrap components. Now Bootstrap on NPM, there are two Bootstrap. There is one Bootstrap version 3. There is Bootstrap 3 and then there is Bootstrap-SAS. Now once Bootstrap 4 comes out, which is pretty close I believe, they are in beta 3 now, then everything will be SAS only. So then you don't have to maintain two different versions. But so you can use this Bootstrap-SAS library, import it, and then you can individually import only what things you need. Yeah? So that's how the entire file looks like. You know, and that gives me benefit of about 10 KBs more, because the Bootstrap CSS min file was 20 KB mini file and gzip. Now I have only 9 KBs with my selection. Okay, so you know, with those different quick demonstrations, here is how you know my application overall looks like. This is before the old application. Oh, I didn't show you the application, sorry. I'll spend a minute to show you the old and new application. So if you look at the application, this is the before application. You can see that, and I'm purposefully on slow 3G right now. Yeah, it is happening. See, now it is still downloading. 11.45 seconds it took for the whole page to download the original untuned version of the application. And as you can see, as I move to the other pages, there is nothing getting downloaded anymore. That means the entire application is already there. Now I can just plug out and still work with the application. But if you look at this application, this is the after tuning application. Yeah. So it finished in 5 seconds and it also got only 41 KB instead of 349 KB. And as I move to movement.js, it will download a new. Right. So that is the lazy loading part that we saw. Okay. So with that, we can quickly see the report now. So this is before. So you can see that the vendor was 2 MB, the total 3 chunks, and all of them had initial flag, meaning they are going to get downloaded at the start. Right? But if you see the new one, I got 4 more new bundles which do not have initial flag. These are the 4 bundles for the other 4 tabs on my application. And my overall home page is only now 241 KB unzipped. So that is what is the difference that you can achieve relatively without a ping. And just for the fun, this is how the new application the stats JSON looks like in the bundle analyzer now. So this is my ol.js, the old ol.js. Now it is all small modules instead of one monolithic ol.js. So you may get different because you may have different requirements. But yeah, so it definitely is using now ES 2015 and things like that. Alright, so quickly summarizing, what did we learn today? Yeah. So if you should be looking at your Webpack JSON file to optimize it. And one way to optimize is do lazy loading using import function, as we saw in the first lazy loading page. We should do pre-shaking, and in order, we should utilize pre-shaking. For that, you have to first choose a library which is ES2015 enabled, right? And which is AOD3 and open layers. Also, you should really look at anything, anywhere you are using this kind of construct. Whenever you say import star from, that means you are bringing everything. There is no pre-shaking now. So if you, even if you are using pre-shakeable library, since you wrote import star, done it. You are not using pre-shaking. Then whenever this is not possible, try to do specialized culling using some plugins, the way we saw it in case of movement.js and lodash.js. Yeah. And also definitely go for SCSS files in order to only include whatever you need in the style world. Right, so that was the summary. Thank you so much. Best of luck for your tuning journey. You can follow me on GitHub, Twitter, Medium, everywhere as Dharap Vijay. Thank you. And the code is here. Thanks.